is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering Orphan Black, Season 5, Episode 2, Clutch of Greed. In this episode, Ferdinand becomes straight-up incel, and I'm getting really irritated with Kira having to run and hide, and it turns out so is Kira. Hooray. Welcome to Unspoiled. I think I'm a clone now. There's always two of me just hanging around. I think I'm a clone now. Cause every chromosome is a heavy down. So, yeah. Kira, poor Kira.
She has had it.
And poor Sarah, but poor Kara.
Hi, everyone. I'm Natasha.
And I'm Maggie. And I'm Maggie.
I feel like I am supposed to feel for Kira probably a little bit more than I do. Mm-hmm. Because I feel like it was really quickly done. The sort of jump to her really being determined to stay.
Right.
But at the same time, as a viewer, I'm really curious about what that kind of study would even look like. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad that this is happening.
Right. And because you've been mentioning a lot about how I feel like you've been getting frustrated with how they've sort of...
They haven't been doing anything with
it. Yeah, they haven't been
her.
Doing anything with it. Like, they mention it, and then they don't, and then it kind of goes away for a while, and then it's like, well, mm-hmm. Wait, is she actually communicating with her, or is this just a hallucination, or what's going on? So for them to actively make this plot about Kira all of a sudden is nice.
Yeah, definitely. But I do, like, you know, I do feel like it's a little abrupt for Kira after seeing everything that Rachel has done to be like, no, I want to go with her and call her Auntie Rachel.
Yeah.
I feel like the show's pushing that a little too quickly for me to believe it.
Right.
Because Kira's sensitive and, like, that shit's gonna leave a mark.
She got locked up there before and was pretty desperate to get out.
Yeah.
So let's not forget that. Although I can imagine, I mean, have any of the sisters that we know of died since Kira has had the ability to feel them like this, or is MK the first time that she's felt this, or felt it and been able to know what it is? I mean, obviously plenty of the clones have died before, but since she was able to say, oh, I know what these feelings are my connections to these people, and then mm-hmm. for one of them to die, I can imagine that would be pretty shocking for her.
Right.
You know, like, the actress does a pretty decent job. I don't think she's the best actress in the world, the little girl, but she does an okay job of conveying just the shock of, I don't feel MK anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Which, that must be fucked up.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like I think you're right that she hasn't, like, the closest I think she got was when, it's kind of, like, up for debate. Because Cosima thinks that she was dying, like, that she had, like, a near-death experience. And that was when Kira was standing right by her bed, and it seems like she feels that Kira pulled her back somehow.
Right.
But the show, like, talked about that, which is a huge thing, and then they just haven't talked about it again at all. So I don't know if I'm supposed to be taking that into account or not. Like, or if they're choosing to sort of drop that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I think you're right. Like, her acting isn't amazing, but she's definitely better than I expected.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we all know how I react to children in TV shows. I'm very predictable with it. So I was very glad, in season one, as soon as I realized that they weren't going to be doing the same old shit with her, I was like, oh, thank God.
Yeah.
But I don't, I just wish that they had spent maybe less time on some other stuff and more time with Kira getting, I don't know if groomed is the right word, but having experiences at least that made her about face here seem more organic.
Yeah.
Because I'm willing to believe it, and I'm that isn't even really the problem. It's just that I didn't see the process of it, so it does feel out of nowhere for me. And maybe that's the, maybe it should, because it certainly feels out of nowhere for Sarah, clearly.
Right.
So maybe that's the point. I don't know. Yeah. Yeah. But anyway, we're beginning at the end here, as we do.
As we do.
As we are wont to do.
We are wont to do that.
I feel like this might be one of the more brutal episodes of this show so far.
Well, we get quite a death, I have to say, from MK.
It is rough.
Yeah.
Rough with two syllables.
Rough.
That's what it's like. And between that and the needle through the face that pins her to a table, these were two moments of me just, like, curling up in a ball and putting my hands over my eyes on the couch.
Yeah.
Like, that moment with the needle, I really went, oh my God! Like, I screamed alone in my house. That was a bad one. So, there's too many needles on the show overall. Can we just, like, agree on that?
I don't like needles.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't even have as big a problem with needles, and I still, this is too many needles.
Yeah.
I think I really need to draw a line. So, So, all right, we start off with Kira shaking Sarah and saying, Mom, you have to let go, which is weird. I'm not sure what that's about, because Mrs. S. says you need to listen to her, which I found a little strange. Like, I thought at first that it was going to be some sort of metaphysical thing. You need to let go, that it was, you know. But the fact that Mrs. S. is standing there and agreeing means that she knows what the hell Kira's talking about here. So I don't know what that... Do you get that? Because she's coming out of being drugged here.
Right.
Right?
So it's still always just a question of, is this stuff that Kira is actually... You know, is Kira actually in her head, or is she legit just hallucinating?
Right.
And it's interesting because I feel like it makes sense in the context of, like, Sarah, you need to let go, you know, by the end of the episode. The idea of, like, maybe you do have to let her go for a while to find out important stuff so that she can find out important stuff about herself, as hard and as scary as that might be. But Kira herself would not know that at the point in time where she is, if she is actually communicating with her mother telepathically, whether she knows it or not.
Right.
She has no context for that yet, because that has not happened yet. And she's not sitting at home thinking, you know what I want to do? I want you to let me go. Because she doesn't want her to let her go at that point. So...
Yeah. Yeah. So,
or Sarah's
thanks
just
for
high.
Being completely unhelpful to me, Meg.
I'm just talking stuff out. I, you know, my job is not to answer questions. It's to, you know, to think about things.
Just be a sounding board. So it turns out, like, that she's in the I didn't expect, because there is, like, a weird thing here where she comes home later. But she she has this vision, and then she wakes up in the institute. Where is she even?
She's a dyad. She even says she's a dyad, which it took me a second, because I was like, they have these rooms with the giant TVs out on the island now, too? And then I was like, oh, no, she just says, I'm a dyad. She's back in that goddamn room with the giant TV screen.
So, I guess you're right, because I, like, for some reason had it in my head... That this, like, she was in bed, but this is all in her head.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, so my question's pretty much moot. I'm dumb. But, yeah, this scene with Ferdinand, man, this guy. I really hate how much, like, how charming he can be. And then he goes and does something like he does later. And it's just like, you are a fucking psychopath. But yeah, he shows her Allison, who is talking to her via Skype. And is like, yeah, I'm here. Helena and Donnie, who knows? Also, Art is here. And he's in the background looking very sinister. Mm-hmm. And he says, there's no more wiggle room, but they're going to want you all to come in. And she says, what about Cosima? And just as those words leave her mouth,
There's Cosima.
And she says, oh, she administered the cure to me, and they want me, if it works, to administer it to all of you. And Sarah's response is, holy shit. And Cosima's like, yes. Mm-hmm. That is what I said also. So that's surprising. I just, you know, you can't trust anything, though. You just can't. Mm-hmm. And then they have a little moment of Kira, who's drawing, and all alone. And he asks her, is Sarah Manning finally ready to behave? Dun, dun, dun. And then we go to credits. So, Rachel...
I have to say, I know this is later in the episode, but I really like the fake Rachel wig rather than the actual Rachel hair.
Can we talk about how much worse actual Rachel's hair was in this episode than usual?
It was really pretty bad.
It was bad enough that I thought maybe that was Sarah before they ever did that thing.
Right, no, because Rachel's, the fake one has, like, little bangs to it. I'm like, oh, mm-hmm. That's cute. And Rachel's, the hairline was, like, frozen really weirdly.
And the sides of it, like, there's always that sort of gap.
Right.
Between, but it was much wider and stiffer looking than it's ever been before. Mm-hmm. It looked like it had been blown out. Like, I don't know what they did, but it just, the only reason that I was like, okay, this can't be somebody in disguise is because it's a scene between Sarah and Rachel.
Right, right.
So there was a moment where I was like, is this somebody? And then I was like, all right, it's not. It's just weird that nobody in costuming or hairdressing seemed to notice. It was distracting to me, frankly, mm-hmm. in this scene for some reason. But it's really amazing, and I know I say this every time, how seamless it is she talks to herself.
Yeah, I forget.
Completely forget.
I forget. I'm like, you know, it's so convenient they found an actress who's, you know, one of sextuplets. That they're able to do this. Like, it's just, I totally forget because she's so fully in each of those characters and mm-hmm. the effects are so good that I'm just like, oh, right.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, even when they're face to face, at one point she's face to face with MK and they're like inches away.
I know.
I looked for the seams. I really tried and I couldn't see them. I don't know how they did it. But yeah, Rachel's here to try and make a deal. And basically, it's, you can have a normal life and Kira can go back to school and everything can be normal if we can just do non-invasive testing and checkups on Kira because we are fascinated with her. Mm-hmm. And Sarah, rightfully, is like, go fuck yourself. Absolutely fucking not. Which, if they were going to follow through on this deal, I would be like, sure, go for it. But why would you ever believe them? And that's what I find so frustrating about how, like, you know, Ferdinand and Rachel are just like, are you ready to behave? Why are you acting like she has been misbehaving? You guys have dicked her over
Right. Every
chance you've had. She has tried to hold up her end of bargains. And you're the, like, so Rachel's trying to make this deal, and Sarah obviously decides that the path of least resistance for now is to act like they're going to do this, but figure out how they're going to get out of it later. which I agree with. I probably would have played it the exact same way mm-hmm. had I been in her shoes. And she brings in Mrs. S and Kira and Fee, actually. Mm-hmm. He hangs out in the background a little bit. But Mrs. S is on board.
Yeah.
Do you think she was really on board? And Sarah convinced her, no, we can't do this? Or do you think she was just saying it also?
I would say I think she was just saying it also, but I could be wrong. That was just my take on it.
Okay. So, meanwhile, Allison is at home going crazy because there are so many things that she needs to do, and they are not letting her out of the house. And Art's amazing new partner, Maddie, doesn't want to... She's like, why don't you get started on making some Christmas cards? Yeah. You're crafty, aren't you? And I'm like, she is crafty. Yes.
But this woman is super annoying.
I hate her.
Yeah.
I hate her so much.
Yep. I forgot that I started hating her pretty much immediately.
Yeah. There's something about her, like... I guess it's just the arrogance that she's, like, the way that she stands in a room, like, she owns the place. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she's going through Allison's stuff and picking things up and flinging her arm around Art like they're buddies. It's just so gross. I hate her.
Yep. She's awful.
So, all right. Helena. The first moment that we see of her here, she's farting up a storm, which is amazing. And Donnie is explaining to her that they did a surgery on her and everything is fine, and he's about to explain when a doctor comes in. And naturally, Helena is very mistrustful of doctors and nurses at this point in life.
Yeah.
And he calms her down, but I honestly, like, he calms her down with the first nurse. By the time we get to the second woman who is, like, fascinated by her embryo, her fetus or whatever, having healed, mm-hmm. I'm kind of on Helena's side. Yeah. There was something going on, right?
It seemed super shady.
It really did. Like, it seemed like that woman had... no problem with Donnie initially. And then once this happened, it's like she called the cops to tell them that he had been abusing her to get him out of the way.
Yeah.
So that she could be alone with Helena. Because the cop coming, like, that was clearly what that looked like, right?
Yeah.
Was like a, well, we need to talk to you, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, there was something. And I'm not saying that she's like Neo or anything, but... Well, she's neonatal. But it's not out of the realm of possibility. And even if she's not, that doesn't mean she's not being shady for her own sake because she wants to, you know, make a breakthrough, publish, perish, you know, whatever,
right.
Doctors. That's my extent of knowledge. I'll just wrap up Helena's thing really quick. She grabs a nurse, smashes her head down, grabs the giant needle that they were going to use on her baby, and smashes it through the woman's cheek down into the cot, like, so that this woman can't move.
Yeah, she's pinned.
And then is like car keys, like as calm as can be.
Mm-hmm.
And runs up out of there with her little tush sticking out of the back of her...
Yeah, I like that detail.
That was pretty cute.
Yeah, that's her butt.
Oh, it's a little butt. She's got like a little Fee painting moment going
on
there.
Yes, exactly.
And she just leaves Donnie, which it's the right call. Like, mm-hmm. he can take care of himself. It's fine. But, damn. And she tells him, nobody else can know where I'm going to hide. Except Sarah, and then tells him, and I, because he says, are you serious? And I have no idea what it is.
Yeah, I don't, I, Yeah.
I'm trying to think what it could even be. It would be amazing if it was Dyad, though. Like, could she go back? I would love to see her try and be fucking Rachel. Helena. Oh, my God. Remember when she's, like, in Rachel's apartment? Doesn't she, like, walk through and, like... Oh, God. Because that's the moment when Sarah's, like, tied up or something. That was a whole scene. Oh,
I do remember that. Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Because she's spying on Rachel, who's fucking Paul, and, like, talking like her, and she has, like, a Barbie with the haircut like her. And it... God, that was really funny. It's this... A lot of dark humor on the show. But, yeah, I have no idea where she could be going. Like, I keep trying to think. I got nothing. All right. Well, that's about it for Helena.
That's her plot.
Yeah. Cosima's is also really, really short. We see her, and she's having lunch with Charlotte. And there's, like, some pills that they're given. And Cosima doesn't want to take them. And Charlotte's kind of interested because she feels like that's what probably makes P.T. Barnum live forever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Cosima's just like, yeah, you know what? No. I don't think so. But thanks, though. I'm not interested in being a guinea pig for yet, like, another fucking thing. And Cosima is showing a ton of interest in this little girl, Aisha. And I don't know what to make of this. Just answer me one question, Maggie.
Mm-hmm.
Did I miss something that would explain this, or is it just a mystery still?
I'm not going to answer that question.
Hmm. Okay. I didn't think that would be a spoilery one, but I defer to your judgment.
And I'm not saying it is spoilery. I might be messing with you and purposefully... unspoilering a spoiler, or no, that's backwards. Spoilering an unspoiler? Yeah, like that.
Is that a thing?
Yes.
Okay.
No, it's not.
No, that's nothing. I don't know. I feel like there's something that I missed, but all right. Well, but that's, like, it for Cosima.
Yeah, I think that's it. You just see her at the beginning and then, again in this...
And then this little moment. Yeah. Okay. All right, so let's get back into, like, the main thrust of the plot here. Sarah gets dropped off at Mrs. S's house with Fee and Kira, and they have to turn on the vacuum cleaner... because they're pretty sure they're being spied on, and, like, even inside the house, that it's bugged or something. Mm. So they're talking about what they're going to do with Kira. And he says that he knows a way to, like, sneak them out of the house. But the way they wind up doing it is much cleverer than what I had kind of thought of. I didn't know what they were going to do, to be honest. Mm. And it doesn't help... not really knowing the configuration of the house beyond just, like, you know, the front window and the front door. But I definitely, because of the way the next scene starts, figure that it would begin, like, that the escape would start before the school day.
Right.
And it doesn't. Yeah. It's after. Which I think they mean for you to think, because it makes it way more tense.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. And they have, like, somebody following behind them, like, 6 feet, this tall, lanky dude, who just, I would call the cops if he were in the schoolyard, I'm just
seriously
saying. He just doesn't look like he needs to be anywhere near these kids. Yeah, that's right. I forgot about this. She drops Kira off, and the homeroom teacher says, "Sorry to hear about your accident. The car accident."
Right.
So it's like they got in touch with him already about what she was going to look like and what was going on, like, which is a little bit creepy also. Mm-hmm. Somebody's communicating on her behalf to her teachers and everything. I forgot about that moment, but for some reason, as sort of innocuous as that is, that kind of made me more uncomfortable than anything.
I was sort of under the impression that the car accident thing was about why Kira had been out of school for however long it was, and they passed it off as, oh, her mom was in the hospital.
Oh.
But I could be wrong about that, too.
Oh, okay. Well, the leaves were, like, fall-looking, so I thought that it was, like, the start of the school year.
Yeah. Well, I think,
but
I feel like they said something about, the only reason I thought that was because I feel like they said something earlier in the episode about her having missed school.
Okay.
While Ferdinand was holding them hostage, basically.
Right. Okay. That makes sense then. Alright, so we go to Fee and Scott and Ira and Hell Wizard.
Oh, Hell Wizard.
And they want him to team up against Rachel. And he's like, well, fucking yeah, I will, because she stabbed my Susan.
Aw, Ira.
And I'm like, Ira, don't ever say that again.
My Susan. Like,
he sounds like a grandpa.
He does. He sounds like such an old man.
Yeah. It's really, like, off-putting. I do not care for it. He's about to call them a bunch of silly gooses. But do we, and I'm trying to see here, because I'm following along with this conversation, that we don't actually get to find out what the plan is here. But we do find out they found MK, and they have new clone phones.
Yeah.
Which is adorable. All with the same, I really wish that the clone phones had, like, custom design cases that said clone phone. Because nobody would know. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it would draw a little bit of attention, but
whatever. It's fine. People would just be like, oh, they cloned somebody's phone. Because that's a thing.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Right? Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, oh, no. That is not the end of Cosima's deal. What am I talking about?
Oh, yeah, because she meets with P.T. Barnum.
Holy shit.
Duh. Yeah.
I can't believe that I completely just breezed past that.
Because we even messaged about
that. That's what I was messaging you about.
Yeah.
I'm such a tool.
P.T. Barnum and his story about the cheese. Yeah.
All right, we'll get there in a second. But first, she meets up with Aisha. Mm-hmm. He came and looked at me, and she says, Cosima says, after the French doctor. So I guess, like, Delphine told him something that made him take a personal interest. Mm-hmm. And this girl has cancer, but it's called a Willems tumor. Mm-hmm. And, or Wilms. Mm-hmm. Aw, she's so cute. She said it wrong the first time. But Cosima says, you must be very tough. And I just love that Cosima is so good with the kids.
Yeah.
Like, I would not know how to handle this. Yeah. And I flatter myself that I would be okay at it. I'm okay. Like, Owen's got some nieces that we see frequently. And we're at the point now where I come in and they come running up and hug me.
Aww.
So I'm doing all right with them.
Yeah.
They're literally the only kids I have any contact with. But Cosima's so good with them.
Yeah, she's always really good with Kira, too.
Yeah. Even Charlotte, the creepy one.
Even the creepy one.
She's so creepy.
Creepy baby clone.
But the fact that she's talking to Aisha seems to have drawn attention, because she immediately gets descended upon by the fucking messenger goober.
Yeah. This guy.
And, alright. This guy. So let's, this house, first of all, I wanted to give a quick shout out here, because unfortunately I called one of my patrons by the wrong name and gave somebody else credit last week.
Yeah, it was Shane.
Yes, Shane Poole had been the one that shared the link to the Orphan Black
bloopers.
But he also shared something this week. It was the fact that the location that the, you know, the big staircase and everything is a reuse of a location from season 2.
Yeah. I thought that was cool.
Yeah, it was, because I didn't even realize that, but he posted the pictures so that you could see side by side. And it's the like when they have the safe house that Mrs. S brings them to, where there's, I think it's the house where there's that big shootout, right?
Is it?
The one where she like goes nuts and pins that woman's hand to the table with knives. Yeah. That was some shit. But yeah, this, so that was kind of cool. But this house, I couldn't help but laugh, because when they get up to the top of the stairs, you find, you see it from the outside, and it's this, like, it looks so much like the McMansions that are here in Texas. Mm-hmm. The, like, weird turret that doesn't make any sense in the front. The windows that are all wildly different sizes. There's different building material. Like, the bottom half of the turret is stone, but the top is, like, plaster or something. And there, I don't know what it is in Texas, but people love turrets. They're everywhere. And I, there's like these neighborhoods where it seems like they're all just, and I'm sure this is exactly what's happening, but it's like people were given Lego sets with pieces like of pick. Houses, yeah. And they just got to pick. And sometimes it's like, oh, I just wanted the simple thing and I'll just stick a turret here. Or sometimes it's like, no, all turrets.
All the turrets.
I just want turrets, please.
My entire house is turrets.
They're fucking all these different building materials. They're brick and stone and plaster and siding.
Have you ever...
They'll pick four.
Have you read the blog McMansion Hell?
Oh, yeah. Yes. Yeah,
it's a lot of that sort of just like these... Exactly what you're describing, the things that are made out of like 18 different materials and like the different... roofs don't meet in actual, you know, Euclidean geometry shapes, and it's just bonkers.
I just, you know, some of them, I'm like, all right, it's not really my style, but in its way, it's cute. But most of them, they're grotesque. Mm-hmm. I don't know who approved this or who put this together on a blueprint and was like, no, yeah, that's right, that's what I want. But there's these entryways that are like 27 feet high, and it's just like the quote porch, and I use that in the loosest term, with this little dangling light lost in darkness at the top that's pointless. You flick the light switch on for that light, it's on the third floor up there. That's not helping anybody. What are you doing? Get sconces, guys, okay? Listen, I have feelings about these houses, but yeah, so I was kind of, like, weirdly amused that I know this is supposed to be, like, this mysterious house that this guy has lived in for, like, 100-something years, but it really doesn't look like that kind of house to me. It just, the inside does, but the outside really looks like he's down here on, like, the suburbs of Dallas, just kind of acting a fool. But yeah, she comes inside, and this place is, like, much more old-fashioned than, obviously, the place that Susan had been living. But there's still this sort of coldness about it, despite that. And there is creepy gramophone music playing. And lots of taxidermied birds. And lots of skeletons of birds. And lots of paintings of birds. Lots of books about birds, some photos of birds.
And a photo of a tortoise.
That's a big old fucking tortoise.
Big old tortoise, and P.T. Barnum, and who is it?
Sir Arthur Conan Doyle,
that's who it is.
That tortoise belonged to Darwin himself. She lived to the ripe old age of 263. All right. This fucking guy. Where did they find this fucking actor? St- Stephen McHattie. Mm-hmm. All right, Stephen. I'm doing this. I'm finding out who the hell you are because...
He's Canadian, I
think. What? I'm just trying to see what else he's been in. Oh, he was in Watchmen. I never saw that. He was in 300 and Shoot 'Em Up. Those are like the only ones that... Oh, he was in A History of Violence. I actually liked that movie. He's been in other things that were well known, but that I haven't seen. He was in Secretary.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I haven't seen that in years. God, I can't imagine
who I never... Was. I should watch that movie. It's been recommended a million times to me, but I just haven't gotten around to it. But yeah, he works a lot, but I just like, he's totally unfamiliar to me, which is part of what I think made him so striking. He has quite a head of hair on him, and I'm sure it's a wig, but like,
it's poofy.
Still?
It's got a big old wave to it that, sort of like what Conan O'Brien's hair does. Like that big wall of hair in the front. I've always enjoyed that. But in a less comical way than Conan's, because Conan's just looks frozen and weird, whereas this is sort of more suave in an old dude sort of way.
My headcanon is that he worked on maintaining his hair via DNA way before he worried about his
anything
age.
Else. Like, it was just all about the hair. You start with the hairline and you go from there.
And he's going to go, like, go public with all of his information, and nobody's going to even give a shit about any of it except the hair thing.
Okay, so how did you keep your hair?
No, you can live until you're 200. But why would I want to do that bald? But, so have you read The Magician's Nephew by C.S. Lewis?
No. Yes.
This is Uncle Andrew.
Oh, man.
This man is Uncle Andrew... in my head to like a T.
Yeah, I can see that.
He's got this manic glint in his eye that it looks like his eyes are like lit from behind. Like, it's really crazy. Mm-hmm. His hair is like really big and lustrous, and you can tell he's kind of vain. He's really like so thin, but in this elegant sort of way that could fool you into thinking he's a gentleman when really he's just nuts. Mm-hmm. Like, his experimentation and his, like, grand speeches that really just come down to, I can do whatever I want. He is Uncle Andrew, like, 100,000%. I couldn't get over it. Even the setting.
Yeah.
You know, they sit down in these armchairs in front of this enormous fireplace, and I'm like, this could be...
Magician's Nephew.
A Narnia book. Yeah.
You nailed it. That's 100% correct.
If you guys haven't read Magician's Nephew, it's on the list of things that I want to cover for the second part of the book club podcast that I'm starting for children's childhood favorites.
It's my favorite Narnia book.
Mine too.
And I'm not a huge Narnia fan, so that's why, like, for a second it took me a minute to recognize the name, but of all those books, that one is the most fun.
It's the most fun. It's, I feel like, probably the least biblical in a lot of ways. And the parts that are biblical are way more creative.
It's just really creative.
Way less ham-fisted.
It's a really creative book, I feel like, compared to the other ones. It's just, and it's, it's the least, least biblical is a good way of thinking of it, too. But, and it's set before the other books, so it's actually a really good entry into the Narnia books, I think. The way they sell them
now... It's supposed to be the first one, and that's how I read them, and I think it's the best way to read them.
Yeah, it wasn't published first. That's how they put them out now, is they put that one out as the first one in the series, because it's the first one in the series. But it wasn't published first. Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe was published first. It was Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe, and then... Prince Caspian, and then Voyage of the Dawn Treader, and then Magician's Nephew, I think.
Oh, it was that late.
I think that was the order that they came out in. I don't know. I just got so bored by Voyage of the Dawn Treader that I just gave up pretty much entirely on everything other than Magician's Nephew at that point.
I have listened to all, but the ones that I really dislike the most are Last Battle, which is like unreadable to me, and Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Mm-hmm. Really don't care for that one, because talk about heavy-handed.
Yeah, a little bit.
But yeah, guys, seriously, it's so good. Just and it's really short, and you can get it's like on Audible, and the dude who narrates it is really, really good.
Oh, cool.
And it's like 5 hours long. So if you take one day, pretty good sized road trip, mm-hmm. you got it, and you will enjoy the hell out of it because it's just super fun. And imagine this fucking guy is Uncle Andrew, and I think there it is. If he only had a British accent, mm-hmm. and said "dem fine woman" a few times. But yeah, so I love this because basically Cassandra wants to know, like, what do you want? And he responds with the, like, well, we loved theological satire back then. And I love just that sentence. She looks so at a loss mm-hmm. right away. Yeah. She's just like, oh, what are we doing? Yeah. Cheeky Arthur imagined a debate between microscopic cheese mice.
And that's the sentence where I was just like,
right?
Yeah, Cheeky Arthur, you're the worst. This guy's going to drive me bonkers saying shit like that.
They argued it long and they argued it strong. And I hear they are arguing it now.
It's like a Seuss book.
She's not 7 years old. What are you doing? She's a fucking scientist. Like, it's not even, if he were even talking to, like, Sarah, I would still have a problem with this, but at least I could be like, well, maybe he thinks she's an idiot because she's not into science. But fucking, there's no reason to talk like this to Cosima.
No, it sounds like he's reading the story of the Zacks from the Sneetches book by Dr. Seuss. They argued it long, and they argued it strong, and they're arguing still, frozen in their tracks. Like, it's just, what are you even talking about, dude? What?
And he's picking up a piece of cheese to really illustrate this point.
Looking at it very carefully in this lovely little cube of cheese.
I want cheese now, though. I'm not going to lie to you.
This was actually product placement by the dairy board. Just the Canadian dairy board. They really want to get you eating more cheese.
Consume. But of all the choice spirits that lived in the cheese, not one of them thought of a cow. And he acts like this was really
super
clever.
Super deep and super clever, yeah.
I hate him. And I really, Cosima clearly hates him. Like, she just looks at him like, I'm not even going to say anything, because what's the point? You clearly are just here to listen to yourself talk.
Yep.
But he gives her full access to the lab to, quote, save your sisters, which I don't buy at all. I don't know what he's up to, but I don't think it's that. And maybe you'll cast your keen eyes in the direction of the cow. And points at himself.
You're the cow.
She really looks like she wants to strangle him. I don't blame her. But, yeah. So that's... You are a cow. Shut up, dude. You suck. All right. So... I jumped a little ahead because that before this happens, we have a thing with MK and Fee.
Mm, right.
Because she broke into his loft, so he went rushing home. But I guess she's not there now? Oh, no, she is here now. That's right. I forgot, because will you lose the slasher mask, please? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Stop it with that. Oh, God. But it turns out she's really sick. And she has basically lost the will to keep running. And she pretty much says that here, but Sarah doesn't really hear it or understand it until they meet up later. I don't think she knows how bad it's gotten. And I don't think, because of how determined MK has been up until now to run and fucking set, like, bombs and shit. Mm-hmm. The idea of her giving up, I just don't think Sarah expected it. You know? Right. And, like, Cosima seems to have a cure. So, in Sarah's mind, we'll just get you out. But, like, MK has spent her whole life running from these people. And she's not about to be like, oh, I'm sick, now I'll come in. Which I 100% understand, but I don't think Sarah gets that. Because she's never been quite as determined to hide in the way that MK has right. done. Basically, hiding has been MK's whole life. Sarah has tried to hide while still, like, trying to live a life yeah. or figure things out in a way. And just, like, surviving wasn't really her thing. She wanted answers, too. So, yeah, so that's that for right now. All right, let me come to fucking Ferdinand and Rachel.
Why? Okay, here's my thing about this scene. Why are they even pantsless with each other?
I don't know what's happening yeah. here.
Like, they took their pants off in some sense that they were going to have, like, did she tell him they were going to have some sort of tantric something? And he's like, yeah, when do you hit me? When does that happen?
Maybe.
And, I gotta say, this is kind of bullshit on Rachel's part. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not gonna do what you know a guy is into, just say, I'm not gonna do that anymore. Don't be like, hey, come over to my place and we'll do some stuff. And then be like, hey, you know what? Never mind. Because that's gonna make him angry. That's not... And, you know, the whole good giving and game sort of situation. Like, no, this is unpleasant for everybody involved. Why are you even doing this?
Yeah, it's like, because I can understand if it's somebody that you've never been with before and you're like, you want to do yeah. what? Oh, I'm not into oh, yeah. that. But she's like, this is a thing with the
this
two
is
of
a
them.
Partnership in a really weird way. Like, they've essentially been dating. We haven't seen her with anybody else, and he's clearly mm-hmm. head over heels for her until now. He's wants to murder her, but, you know, he's unhinged, so right. let's not read too much into that other than he's evil and always has been. He hasn't really yeah. been hiding it. But, like, what are you doing? What are they doing? And then, I don't, like, to yeah. be, like, just sort of disappointed that he's not down with whatever her new... jam is, which mm-hmm. seems to be celibacy, honestly. Like, it's not like she even wants to do anything. She just wants to sit there with their pants off.
I'm not sure about that, because she says, I'm not going to hit you, and he, like, immediately gets up and starts to get dressed. So I feel like she might have been okay with just having vanilla sex.
But I feel like it seemed like
he's
they'd
so
been,
not on board
yeah,
with that.
It feels like they'd been sitting there for a little while, though, because he seems very boggled by the fact that they're not doing anything. Because mm-hmm. doesn't he say, like, when does it start to hurt? So I don't know how long they've been sitting in this position. Yeah,
I didn't even notice that line.
Yeah. That kind of cracked me up. That's when I was like, what's happening?
And also, I'm not a big fan of the, like, oh, I had an empty part of me and that's why I had this kink, but now I'm
yeah,
better.
Yeah, that's some bullshit right there.
Like, yeah, I'm not sure that the show is, like, saying that, or if that's just her bullshit yeah. or what. But I was just kind of like, okay. And this is when she says, you can be part of this change, or you can be part of the past. And, you know, she's still looking at this like it's a business transaction. Yeah. She doesn't understand the depths of... His feelings for her feels like I'm giving him way too much credit.
Right. Like, I want to say, because... you know, she doesn't owe him shit. But at the no. same time, I feel for him in a weird way. Mm-hmm. You know, because it's so hard to be dealing with somebody who is an absolute sociopath, except for he's deeply just enamored of this one person. And... to have that one person be like, yeah, no, we're not going to do that. The thing that was like the bond between the two of us, I'm chucking that unilaterally. You know, he's getting dumped.
And what's kind of funny about it is that I really think he's only as drawn to her as he is because she is totally unavailable to mm-hmm. him. Like, that's the appeal. Mm-hmm. But she's always been just unavailable enough. Right. And now she's really just not going to play at all. And so now it's different.
Yeah. Now he's going to go, as you said, full incel.
Full incel. He's snaping it.
Yeah. He's snaping it.
he's going to snape this one. All right. So then we go into the whole charade with
the shenanigans getting Kira out of school.
Yeah. This is one of those things that I'm always like, I would have liked a bit of like a humorous moment of them trying to find the buckled cape that she wears on the internet. And they, like, find it, and it's, like, a $4,000 cape, and they're like, oh, fuck's sake.
Right, like, let's be honest, there's no way they could afford her actual wardrobe. Like, how did they put this together?
And those are the details that I always get hung up on with stuff. Like, there was an episode of Poirot where somebody replaces another person pretending to be dead to throw off the timeline of when somebody has died so that they have an alibi for the time it seems like she died, when in fact she's murdered later. And the person pretending to be dead has the same exact bathing suit as the woman who died. And, like, they've planned this whole thing ahead, sure, but the woman is not close enough friends with them that they would know what bathing suit she owned. Right. Like, that, and that, because Poirot is one of those shows where everything is explained so meticulously. Right. But that was something that just nobody asks about or says anything about. Even the woman who pretends to be the woman in the bathing suit even brings self-tanner to, like, make herself look more tan. And so we get an explanation in depth about the self-tanner, but we never get an explanation on how she knew about to get that bathing suit. And I was just like, how are you going to not talk about that, though? Like, that's the whole thing. So, yeah. The fact that the wig, fine. But the clothes, how, though? It's a pretty great cape. So, yeah. There's the whole, like, switcheroo and, oh, no. And then they caught us. And we're going to duck this way. And we're going to... And then I'm going to hand her off. And I'm going to go all by myself. And, Mrs. S is the one that takes off with Fee and Kira going out the other side. And Sarah gets in the car and she decides that she's going to flee to Fee's place. Only she just underestimates how many people are on the case right now. Because Ferdinand follows her there. And there's, like, kind of a tense moment where MK calls her and tells her that she's watching, and you have 5 seconds to hide, and she has to hide behind, like, a garbage bin, and then sneaks upstairs. And it's kind of weird, because rather than seeing her car and seeing that Sarah is not outside, he doesn't assume that she's already up in Fee's apartment. Which is kind of weird, right? Like, he just walks around outside
looking for her.
For 10 minutes looking for her. I don't get that. And I know it's... There really isn't a good explanation for it other than they needed to give her time. Yeah. But it is... I did expect him to head straight up there. And when he didn't, I was like, there's no good reason why he's not doing that. But she goes up in tens, and I don't know how, to, like, get MK to pack up her stuff and for both of them to flee. I don't know how she thought they could do that. Because, like,
Ferdinand's right there.
There's one way in and out of this place. Your car is right next to his. I don't know what she's thinking here. But it doesn't matter. Because what Sarah decides to do is, well, I guess there's not one way in.
I think she must go out a window in the bathroom or something like that.
Yeah. MK insists on doing this because she's dying and just... It's like, you know, I'm just going to sacrifice myself to this cause. So she trades clothes and puts on the Rachel wig and lures him in. And he thinks she's Sarah initially. And when she turns around and she's not Sarah, he's delighted. And I really thought this was going to turn into a rape scene.
Yeah.
I thought that's for sure where we were heading, and I was like, can we not?
Right. And they didn't.
Thankfully, they did not. But, yeah, he says something about, like, you don't know what a volcano, the sight of that outfit is igniting in me. Mm. Something like that. Something really, like, fucking, the kind of thing that an incel would write. Yes. I said it once.
You keep saying it. I
said it 1,000 times. Yeah. And he, like, holds her down and is talking about how he's going to finally complete the Helsinki project. And then he stands up on her chest, is calling her Rachel. And she's saying, you can't hurt me anymore. And he says, oh, yes, I can. Because you've hurt me. And then just starts to chant, you hurt me, as he jumps up and down on her chest until she's dead. That is one of the most horrible deaths I think I've seen on television.
Impressive.
There's something about the combination of the pure physical brutality of jumping up and down on somebody like that. Him talking to her as if she's another person, so that her whole, like, personhood and humanity is absolutely irrelevant. Yeah,
completely not there in the moment of her death.
Yeah. And the weird, like, break between when he realizes that he's killed her and how he suddenly seems to almost be sorry, or maybe just shocked at himself. There's just a look of almost alarm on his face. Mm-hmm. And he, like, softly places the, what do you call it, lamb mask over her chest.
Right.
That creeped me out so bad. And this is all intercut with Kira resisting getting into the getaway van. And finally, she says, MK is dead. And Sarah just keeps on insisting, no, she's not. She's going to be fine. She's not dead. She's fine. Even though Sarah knows perfectly well. And then she tries to pick Kira up and force her into the van, and Kira is fucking not having it. And then she just says, I want to know why I'm like this. And the most surprising part to me was that Mrs. S was like, you heard her. And I was like, Mrs. S, don't do this. I wanted her to talk sense to, and by sense I mean be the most suspicious. But, like, nobody is suspicious enough to me at this point except for right. Sarah.
Yeah, Mrs. S signing off on this does seem a little unlike her because, you know, yeah. Rachel.
Yeah. Ugh. But it looks like the van just leaves, right?
Yeah, I think Mrs. S tells him to go.
Because I kind of had wondered if, you know, Sarah was going to leave without, but she, like, goes and stands by the water and is staring, like, I mean, this would fuck me up after everything she went through.
Yeah.
For her daughter to just be like, no, I don't want to go.
Yeah.
I'd be so irritated.
And
I just,
MK kind of died as a result of all the stuff they just did to try and get Kira out of there. So it's mm-hmm. sort of like, well, MK died for absolutely no reason at all.
Yup. Yeah.
Boo.
I hate it. Thanks, I hate it. I just, like, I really enjoyed MK, too, yeah. just as a character, because she was used so sparingly,
yeah.
and she was like Helena, but, like, techno Helena, you know what I mean? Because right. she had the street smarts and, like, the brutal streak, but it was much more, it was much less of, like, an aggro thing and more of a defense thing, but still, her skills were, like, mad useful. She had this really intense understandable vendetta. That was, like, a really great backstory. Mm. And I'm a little bummed that she's gone now, to be honest, you know? Like, I mean, at least they paid tribute with a hell of a death.
It was a hell of a death.
And fucking Ferdinand is like, I'd like to think that me killing her had something to do with them capitulating. Mm. And I'm like, I guess. But he doesn't know anything about Kira, does he? So why would he even think that?
Yeah, that's fair.
You know what I mean? I just don't know what he thinks he did. Right. If he isn't aware of her psychic link. Well, maybe he is. I don't know what they know. I don't know what Kira's told them while she's been in custody. You know? But in any case, he intended, I think, to try and, like, get Rachel to begrudgingly admit that he was crucial. She ain't. She is not going to give him any sort of satisfaction here. And basically has somebody escort him off the premises. And, I'm not exactly looking forward to whatever's going to happen with him, because he's not going to just go away. I can't imagine that...
He'll just be like, alright, bye.
Yeah, well, I guess she dumped me. So now I'm just gonna go, live... I imagine him having this, like, palatial estate on some, like, Italian vineyard somewhere.
Well, maybe he used to, but he doesn't have any money anymore. MK took all his money.
That's right, I forgot about that.
Yeah, he broke. I mean, if he already owned property, fine, but he can't, you know, feed himself.
Wow. That's pretty satisfying. Yeah. So yeah, then he's definitely not going anywhere. He's going to have to do something. So then we cut from that to Sarah giving Kira over to Rachel. And Rachel saying, we're going to take such good care of you.
Oh, the look on her face. Oh, bitch.
And Sarah, her acting in that scene where she's just, like, trying to hold it together and she's, like, about to just lose it, and her daughter turns and looks at her, and Rachel, like, holds eye contact as she slams the car door shut. I was just like, you fucking... I hate her so much.
Yep. That seems to be the moral of every episode.
I hate Rachel.
I hate her so much.
So, everybody's, like, gone to bed except for Mrs. S, who's drinking and wearing scarves. It's sort of her deal. And there's a knock at the back door. And she goes and checks and it's fucking Delphine. Which is the, like, I was trying to guess who it was. That didn't even enter my mind.
She's supposed to be in Sardinia.
Yeah. What? Yeah. So she's comes in. And tells her, like, that nobody else can know that she's here. That, you know, I don't know who to trust. Mrs. S says, neither do I. Very pointedly. And it's safer that they don't know if we're communicating. And Mrs. S just says, I'm listening. And that's it. So, yeah. That's that. That's the end of the episode. I don't know what Delphine's do. Like, I don't know anything. I got no knowledge. I'm really curious, though. Like, what is... There's clearly something about that little girl, Aisha, right?
Right.
But I don't know what it could be. She has a certain kind of cancer. Like, is it, like, tortoise cancer that you can, like, live forever from it?
I don't know. That kind of cancer. I'm looking it up.
But, yeah, so Wilms' tumor,
is a nephroblastoma, cancer of the kidneys that typically occurs in children rather and rarely in adults. Highly responsive to treatment, with about 90% of patients surviving at least 5 years.
That's interesting. Because there's something about the, like, I'm wondering if he didn't tell her she had something different than what she actually has. Because there's something about the way that Cosima's like, you must be pretty tough, that made me think, like, she's surprised at the girl's symptoms not being worse. Mm. But I don't know. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, it could just be a more advanced case because they didn't find it early enough. I mean, any kind of, you know, perfectly treatable kind of cancer can be deadly if you don't know about it.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I don't know. I've got, like, normally I have, like, a little something that I feel like I can, like, build off of and just be wild and, you know, a little ridiculous with.
Make it like an episode of House where you can somehow take this information and be like, this is going to lead to this and this and this.
Right? Yeah. Or Poirot, where he, like, just, he figures out people's, like, whole lives off like of a frame wrapper. Pocket square. Yeah. Yeah, I don't understand what about this fucking creepy ass dude has inspired Rachel to suddenly feel like her life is complete. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And he's got real, like, good hair. I mean, you gotta believe what a, you know, when a guy with that good hair says, you know, something was missing inside of you, I am that thing that was missing, you're gonna say, yeah, cool.
I'm just, like, there's the moment when Ferdinand asks her, have you two, and she doesn't really answer, and I'm like, have they been fucking? I really don't want that to be a true thing, please, ever. It's very incestuous, right. You know, like, I know that they're not actually bloodline related, but there's something about that. Yeah. Gross. All right, well, with that lovely image.
The end.
I'm trying to think if there's anything more that I wanted to say. I feel like I'm just leaving this with just like, well, everything is terrible, and the Crypt Keeper is scary, and I hate Rachel. What else is new?
Right.
You know what I'm wondering now? I'm like, as much as I hate Rachel, it seems like technically, at the moment, everyone is sort of on the same side.
Mm-hmm.
So could Ferdinand come back as sort of the big bad that's up against Rachel and thus now up against everybody, mm-hmm. just because she has finally aligned herself with them? But that would be so frustrating because I hate her so much because of everything that she's done and how much she's fucked everybody over. And if it turns out that he becomes the big bad because of her, that's just her fucking everybody over again, inadvertently. Yeah. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So,
can I tell you a funny I hate Rachel fact? So,
yes,
when I said the thing about how we just end every episode with saying I hate Rachel, it reminded me of the fact that basically the only Funko Pop that is still readily available is the Rachel Funko Pop.
Oh, yeah, shit.
Yeah, so I'm looking at this right now. The Sarah one is over $40. Cosima is almost $100.
Wow.
And Rachel,
$349. Ouch. Damn.
Yeah.
And it's the one with the pencil
in her
eye,
the one
right?
with the pencil in her eye is $16.49.
Okay.
So, you know, that's a reasonable price. But the $349, that's pretty bleak. She's holding a martini in that one.
Oh, that's kind of lame.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, Felix, you get to see his butt, and Rachel's just holding the martini.
Oh, butt.
Yeah, so anyway, I just remember knowing that when I was looking at Orphan Black Funko Pops, being like, I want to buy some of these, and being like, oh, they're all so expensive. Oh, I could get Rachel. No, thank you.
I wish I could remember who it was that sent me Fee and Allison. But whoever you are, thank you, because they're great. Although I have had a moratorium in my office of no more
Funko Pops.
Funko Pops. I just have nowhere to put them
I
now.
Pretty much have nowhere to put them. And yet today I bought Biggs, Porkins, and Wedge, the 3-pack from Star Wars.
Oh, my God.
Because I'm ridiculous.
Ma'am!
I know. It was a good price. I can't not. I love Wedge. And it's the most boring Funko Pop, the Wedge Funko Pop, because Wedge is so just generic looking and hey, look, a white guy flying a plane, you know, is basically who Wedge is. But I love him. And so now I have a very boring Funko Pop of him. But Biggs at least has a cute little mustache, because Biggs has a funny mustache. And Porkins is not fat, which is kind of a bummer.
The only Funko that I think I would make an exception for is the Nearly Headless Nick one that came out.
Oh.
Because that one's rad as fuck.
I don't think I've seen that.
I shared it in the group a little while ago. It's all like that semi-transparent crystal blue.
Oh, yeah, I see it.
And like, yeah. And there's a basilisk one that's like a 6-inch. It's like the size of the Hagrid one. And that one's pretty cool. But that one's a Target exclusive. And I think it's really expensive now.
Mm.
But I just like the ones that are real weird looking at this point.
Yes. I generally too.
Anyway.
Wedge. Anyway. But yeah, if I could get one of the Sarah ones for a reasonable price, I would get a Sarah one. But I'll make do with just Felix.
I would like a Helena.
There's a good Helena one where she's like in a bloody dress, basically.
Yes!
Yeah, she looks a real mess.
Alright, well, new patrons this week, we just have 3. We have Avery Vinson, Laura Allison, and Leon Dwan. So welcome to all of you. Thank you very much for becoming patrons. Make sure to join the Patrons Only Facebook group. And I want to remind you all that we're going to be doing the book clubs live on Crowdcast, I believe, from now on. And I say I believe because not every co-host is like down to do Crowdcast. So I'm not going to say every single one, but for the most part. And I'm going to try and post the links for those ahead of time on the Facebook page for the show. And those aren't going to be patrons only. Those are going to be for everybody. Just because I really like the crowd involvement, especially with the children's ones, which I feel are like going to be just close to a lot of people's hearts and they're going to want to talk about them. So keep your eyes open for that. The one that's coming up is going to be Eleanor and Park. Saturday, what is it? July. I can't believe it's going to be July already. Oh my God. It's too fast. July 7th at 2 in the afternoon, Central Standard Time. So join us for that. The link is up on facebook.com/unspoiledpod. You can also find us at on Twitter at Unspoiled Show, Instagram at Unspoiled Podcast, and at unspoiledpodcast.com. Is there anything you would like to add, madam?
No, I think I'm good.
Okay. Well, you know what? I just remembered, because you did mention this last week. We're going to be starting Legion again.
Oh, right. Yeah.
So if you guys have not listened, or if you haven't watched the show, first of all, get your life, because that show is one of the best shows on television. Secondly, if you haven't listened to our show on it, it's one of my favorites that we've ever done.
Yeah.
So definitely check out Unspoiled Legion. And third, if you want to follow along with us, do that.
Yeah.
That's about
it. Yeah.
But Legion's pretty fun.
It is. I agree with that.
So yeah. All right, cool. Well, thanks everybody so much for listening. Make sure to leave a review on iTunes that says I like Maggie. And we will see you next week with a new episode. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Isn't it strange? Feels like I'm looking in the mirror. What would people say? If only they
was an Unspoiled Network podcast.